Thank you. First, I wanted to thank everyone for coming out in this weather. All very courageous. I'd like to talk a few minutes on the Brazilian composers. Camargo Guarnieri and Villa-Lobos. They are maybe the two best Brazilian composers. They were apart for 25 years. Villa-Lobos died in 59. Guarnieri died in 93. And they have lots of similarities and many differences. And I would like to talk a little bit about them. They both studied in Paris. They both went to Paris, so that both music sound actually reminds us a little bit of French music. The difference is, Villa-Lobos was much more flamboyant, you know, as a personality. He, you know, with his cigar, he composed music. He turned the radio off, out loud, very loud, and then that's how he composed, with his cigar, you know, smoking. Guarnieri was more systematic, was a pedagogue. Most of the major composers today in Brazil studied with Guarnieri. Villa-Lobos was self-taught. So what happens then? Villa-Lobos, in a way, his music is more virtuosic, it shows off better. Guarnieri's is more technical. Everything is, every note is put together, just like Mozart. And by the way, his first name was Mozart. Mozart Camargo Guarnieri. And one of the main differences is that Villa-Lobos used to, he went all over Brazil collecting folk songs. So he's, you know, he was one of the fathers of the nationalism in Brazil. He started collecting folk songs and then composed music based on those folk songs. He would use those folk songs and create variations, address the melodies in different formats. And Guarnieri, on the contrary, was very proud to say that he never used one melody that was he hadn't written. Actually, only one work he did of his output, which is a work for canon orchestra, which is a set of variations. So he used a borrowed theme. Because what Villa-Lobos, what Guarnieri did was he used, he made melodies that sounded Brazilian. While Villa-Lobos used melodies that were Brazilian. So it's two different aspects. And the set of, I'm going to play two dances. It's out of three actions, a set of three dances. I'm going to play two of Guarnieri. These are these works are also orchestrated by himself, and they were recorded. They were very famous, these works, and they were recorded by Leonard Bernstein and the American Philharmonic in the 60s. So, hope you enjoy it. You're never good. Thank you.
give us a little bit about yourself and about this program tonight. And I thought we'd start off by asking you to expound on the fact that you were born in California, raised in Brazil, and how you wound up to become a fixture in New York. So. Yes.
My father, a mathematician, he went to get his doctorate at Stanford in 1963. <Here's my age. laughs> And then we moved back. I was 3 years old, so my parents are Brazilians, and so I think I was very fortunate to be able to grow up in a different culture, different country, and then be able to enjoy both. Because I was 10, 11, I kept coming back and forth to the United States. But this experience in a different country, I think, is very, very valuable. And so I came to New York in 84, and that was it. Up here in New York, there's no anywhere else you can go.
I'm here too. So I'd like to ask you a little bit about, or at least a mention that, you know, our experience of pianists, there really are all kinds of types of pianists. And the way you play Chopin and Debussy, but I'm thinking Chopin in particular, you know, it's, to me, it's so different than that I've heard other people play Chopin. Is that your teachers? Is that your ear? Because to me, there's more of a flow to yours rather than sort of an attack. And it reminds me of more of the salon that maybe was historically.
That's an interesting question. I do have an affinity for Chopin. However, I was in a competition in Palm Beach, Florida, and one of the judges was a Polish pianist, Barbara Hasek-Bukowska. Even though I didn't get a prize, she was very impressed, I guess. She invited me to study with her in Poland. I went to study. I lived with her for 4 months. And she was a goddess in Poland. I only went there to study Chopin, for you to see how big her name is. So for example, her son was driving her and was speeding. So the policeman stops her. And when he sees that Lukowski is in the car, he lets them go. A few years ago, I was back in Poland, and I wanted to contact her. I hadn't seen her in many years. And I couldn't find her number. So I called the operator. And I said, I'm looking for a number. She said, okay, is it a private person or a public person? I said, so private. Okay, who is it? As soon as I say Barbara Hasek-Bukowska, she says, no, this is public person. Cannot be. So then I went on and on, how I lived with her. I haven't seen her in many years. I went on and so she finally gave me the number. That was her answer. It shouldn't happen here, you know? But she always used to say, in Chopin, you never attack the piano. Never. You know, it's always coming. And she used to demonstrate, even that first note of the first ballade, how it's just a full sound of the forte, never an attacked sound. So, and while I was there, I heard every lesson she gave every day and played for her every day for 4 months. So it was an incredible experience. And then to finish it off, she always wanted to have a drink at around 6 o'clock. And she wanted me to drink with her. And I was 26 at the time, and I said, okay, let's make a deal. I said, I'll drink with you every night, on one condition, that you play for me every night. And she agreed. And so every night we would drink, and then she would sit and play mazurkas and waltzes, and she only played Chopin, and it was a fantastic experience.
I've never heard all that, but that's that would do it. I'd just like to put everybody's attention to the back page. At the top, we kind of have a new section, upcoming events. And so I'd like you to read that, but I'd also like to point out that the last event is the annual Joseph H. Conner Benefit Gala. And as you were talking about Palm Beach, I was reminded that I got to know you through Joe Conlon.
Which I met in that particular competition. He was the master of ceremonies of that competition.
He took me down and I worked on that competition for a number of years.
And I'm pleased to say that I'm wearing his cufflinks tonight.
Very special. And he's also been at a number of the benefits, and he spoke, I guess, like 2 years ago about Joe and his experiences there. So another luminary, and that would be New York, too. Finally, I'd like to get to the Guarnieri in particular, because you have, for tonight, he also has for sale lots and lots of Guarnieri, and this Guarnieri seems to be a huge, epic project that you're working on. I see a double CD of solo works, and then there's all of the piano concerti and two separate CDs. And I would have to say that what you gave us tonight is a very popular version of Guarnieri, but there's also a lot of challenging music to our ears. So would you give us a little taste of what you're offering?
Guarnieri, the whole thing started was a very interesting, because it started again, Joe Conlon had to be involved, you know, because I was invited to play with Thomas Conlon, the conductor, you know, which because Joe recommended me. They were doing a Brazilian program in West Virginia. And so I sent him a series of recordings of Brazilian concertos. And he picked up a concerto that was light, and you know, he wanted something, you know, for his public. Many years later, in the cruise, because Joe used to do the cruises too, and I was playing in the cruise, and so was Tom Conlon. So we both meet at the cruise, and we're sitting drinking over wine, and he says to me, "You know, Max, remember those concertos you sent me?" And I said, "Yes." I said, "Well, I didn't choose a particular one, you know. I think those are great." We were just talking about the Guarnieri concerto. I sent you. It was a live recording with Guarnieri, very bad quality, that got into his hands. So he said, "You know, Max, why don't we, instead of doing 10 little projects, it's better to do one big project. Why don't we record the whole Guarnieri concerto?" And I went, "Whoa." Six concertos are massive. They're all in manuscript form. Just to read it was like unbelievable, because the notes are this tiny, you know, and it's all this, you know, a lot of it. There's so many notes. And so Joe was part of this too. So then we did the recordings. The first recording of the concerto, the first three concertos got in the 100 of the Billboard, you know. I got a letter from the president of Naxos congratulating me, and they wanted more. And then we decided to do, after we finished all the six concertos, we decided to do all the solo piano music. It's going to be six CDs. So the first two came out recently. The dances that I played are in those CDs. And so that's, you know.
Well, I would like.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Just maybe it would be interesting to say that Max was bringing the Brazilian folk instruments to the
audience. Oh, yeah, yes. There was one concerto in particular that used carnival instruments, you know, one is called a cuica, which is a sort of a drum with a stick that you, you know, and certain ones that you play that in Brazil they play in carnival, and those samba ensembles. So I had to go to Brazil. I had to bring like three different percussion instruments that no orchestra has. They only have them in Brazil. So I brought them there. It was very funny because I left them overnight at the symphony. And before the recording, I made sure I came early to show them how to play it, you know? But when I got there, they're playing it already. they already knew the instrument inside out, of course. You know, you get percussionists, they give them, you know, anything and they'll make music out of it.
Well, to finish up, would you be willing to do a little encore for us? All right. Now, normally, if Joe were here, he would insist on you doing Tico Tico, but I'm going to give you the choice because I know you have lots of other proposals.
Yes, I'm going to play a tocada by another Brazilian composer. Also, this piece was written in 1980, and he got an award, an award in France for a compositional award in a competition in France, 1980. It's part of a triptych. It's the last movement. It's called Toccata. And you will see it resembles, you know, a little bit of Poulenc, Prokofiev, but in the middle he is, because he was a very he was a fabulous pianist and a Liszt fan. He was recording on Liszt at the time, and he's stuck in the piece a theme of Liszt that you're going to recognize. I hope. So his name is Amaral Vieira.
CDs, and of course, our artists will be happy to sign them to talk to you about them.